Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grape, Olive, Pig: Deep Travels Through Spain's Food Culture by Matt Goulding. Narrated by Will Damron. Forward. In Correspondence with Bourdain, How This Book Was Born. Dear Tony, I went out last night for a quick drink down the road, cold, dark vermouth from a dim bodega in the shadow of an ancient church. A friend showed up with the promise of the best croquetas in town. He was right. The crunch of a chicharrón, the molten, savory flow of jamón lava. The night marched on, from oil-slick anchovies to pimentón-dusted octopus, small tubes of cerveza to big bellies of beefeater. As my plans to return to work vanished in a slipstream of crushed grapes and pork fat. I woke up to a half-eaten shawarma on the bedstand and a note scribbled on a napkin. Great ball of pig? Grape, olive, pig. The most common reaction to rice, noodle, fish, our love letter to Japanese cuisine, has been three words long. I am going. That's what we set out to do, inspire and contextualize travel while leaving readers room to make their own discoveries. But now that we have a look, a style, a voice, it would be a damn shame not to take it to another delicious corner of the world. And I think I have just the place. We change the history of the world, a chorizo-cheeked chef once told me in Madrid. Maybe it was the gin talking, but he had a point. The Spaniards brought tomatoes and chocolate and chilies to the old world, sugar and wheat and smallpox to the new world. They forged one of the world's first fusion cuisines, not fusion as a six-letter word, but a cuisine of confluence, where the slow tide of Phoenicians and Romans, Jews and Moors and Catholics washing over the Iberian Peninsula gently but resolutely shaped its character. Like the sting of a padrón pepper, it creeps up on you gently, in the hint of cinnamon in grandma's meatballs, or the stain of saffron in a proper paella. More a whisper than a full-throated pronouncement. Not that the Spaniards don't know how to shout. After all, this is the country that invented foams and spheres and the 40-course tasting menu. But Spain's greatest virtue lies in that time-tested Mediterranean formula. Beautiful local ingredients, impeccable technique, and a ravenous appetite for all manners of flora and fauna. The Spaniards sucked the brains from shrimp heads, crunched sardine spines like potato chips, throw elaborate wine-soaked parties to celebrate spring onions. There are stories to tell here. From what I've heard in our conversations, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Food that will make your toes curl. People you want to name your children after. The fact that we first met over roasted snails and cava in the Catalan countryside brings this thing full circle. We'd go with the same squad from Roads and Kingdoms, Doug Humanic painting with pixels, Nathan Thornburg flexing from the edit desk. And assuming those nice folks down on Broadway dig on canned seafood and blood sausage, Harper Wave putting the ink to paper. What do you think? Saludos, Matt. Dear Matt, so it's the end of an epic meal in Andalusia, as so many in Spain seem to be, and I'm sitting at the table, enjoying a few moments of woozy happiness, when the chefs emerge from the kitchen and join me. They are friendly, but strangely wary. You know, Señor Anthony, that we in Spain like you very much. We like your book. We like your shows. There was an uncomfortable silence as I waited for the but that seemed sure to follow. But people say things. Here in Andalusia, in Madrid, they say you are close, too close, to the Basques. Which is, of course, kind of true. My first and closest connections to Spain came through the great Basque chefs Juan Marie Arzac and his daughter, Elena. It was culinary educator Luis Irizar and his daughters who first led me, stumbling through the nighttime streets of San Sebastian, eating wonderful things unlike anything I'd experienced before. Juan Marie has since become as close to a father to me as anyone since my dad passed. The phone still rings late at night, and it's him, the two of us struggling in our broken French and Spanish to communicate, but somehow always managing. And, of course, the equally obstinate Catalans grabbed a hold of my heart early and often. Ferran and Albert Adrià making it their personal mission to show me how good, how insanely good, ham could be. How stuff that came in a can could be divine. Showed me, as they showed the world, the glorious extremes of human creativity. It's not that I loved the south of Spain any less. It's just that I came late to the party. Spain, for me, is a country of grown-ups. When I'm asked where I'd like to die, specifically at what table, I always picture myself in Spain, sagging to the ground with a blissful expression on my face at Echebarri, an austere yet revelational restaurant in the mountains near San Sebastian, where most dishes have only three ingredients, the principal protein, a single perfect prawn, a spoonful of fish eggs, a slab of exceptional beef, olive oil, and salt. It's fitting that you chose Spain to follow rice noodle fish. There are, I've long believed, similarities between the two countries and their approaches to food. The embrace of single ingredients done as well as possible, the love of tradition, the mania for great seafood. The poteo, that uniquely awesome bar crawl, bouncing from place to place, scooping delicious, delicious things into your mouth between glasses of wine, wild mushrooms, little plates of slow-braised cheek, slices of acorn-scented, fat-rippled ham, ridiculously tiny sea cucumbers, squid and octopus seared on the plancha, grilled turbot, slow-cooked tripe with hunks of chorizo, going out to eat dinner at midnight. Think about Spain, and the mind reels. You could hardly pick a better place to eat, to write about, to die. Cheers, Tony. Dear Tony, like you, my love for Spain was born in the north. It struck first in Barcelona, 18 years old and goosebumped by everything that passed before my eyes. Later, I fell in with the Basques, learned the art of pilpil and pinchos crawls at the hands of Luis and Vici Irizar. Finally, I found a more permanent solution to my courtship with this country. I fell hard for a Catalan girl and somehow convinced her to marry me. I've called Barcelona home since 2010, and I've used the years since to roam the peninsula like an Iberian pig in search of fallen acorns. I've eaten baby goat with the horsemen of Andalusia, crushed sea urchin in the cider houses of Asturias, scraped socarrat from paella pans with the abuelas of Alicante. My appetite for this country knows no one taste or territory. Make no mistake, this ain't Japan. I can't hide behind my gaijin status here. I married into this country and claim to understand its cuisine. At the very least, I've consumed enough calories over the years that I'd be a knucklehead not to have learned something along the way. The book I'm thinking about is a more personal, intimate book than Japan. To write it any other way would be to ignore the role my family and friends have played in shaping my understanding of this country and its people. Here I am part insider, part outsider, a position not without its possible perils, but maybe it gives me something to say. These are well-traveled grounds I traverse. The titans of the Wandering Scribes Club, Dumas, Orwell, Papa, have been peddling their opinions on Spain for centuries. More than the foreign contingent, though, the Spaniards claim a long tradition of heavyweight epicures who wield their pens as voraciously as their forks. Nestor Luján, Simone Ortega, José Carlos Capel, men and women with big thoughts about food and huge footprints in the kitchens across Spain. All of this is to say that I would be wise not to fuck this up. Luckily, I've had a lot of really smart people along the way to guide me to the good stuff. Rice masters, fish whisperers, the brothers Adrià, my in-laws. Your buddy José Andrés has been my most trusted consigliere on all matters of the stomach. He cracked open in me a wide and wonderful curiosity for Spain many years ago, which I've been probing ever since. More than specific restaurants or dishes, it's the people and the stories behind the food that I want to build this book around. A pack of sisters who brave the elements to scrape gooseneck barnacles from the cracks and crevices of the Galician coast. A band of fishermen off the coast of Cadiz who maintain the world's oldest fish hunt. And, in the sun-baked mountains near Granada, in the cave community of Fuente Nueva, my wife's 87-year-old great-uncle, Chacho Federo, the last of a dying breed of Andalusian shepherds. I've been pocketing these stories for years, saving them in the dank bodega of my mind, like a bottle of 74 Vega Sicilia, waiting for the right moment to decant and drink. Now's the time. Un abrazo, Matt. Matt, might I respond to your last with a resounding fuck you? You got me beat, by a mile. No matter how much I love Spain, no matter how many friends I think I have, however well connected I thought I was, how sincere my love for the food, the lifestyle, you've got me beat, by a mile. You fucking live in Barcelona. Who doesn't want to live in Barcelona? You had the good sense to marry a Spaniard, which means, in my limited experience, that you often come home to find an Iberico ham casually deposited on the kitchen counter next to a knife. You are on close terms with Juan at that incredible counter in the Boqueria. You go out to dinner at midnight, start drinking again at noon, nap around 3, nibble on olives and little bites of awesomeness when you rise, and pretty much live the dream. So, yeah, fuck you, Matt. I hope the next Roads and Kingdoms book is on Orlando. Suerte, Tony. Chapter 1. Barcelona. On Saturday, April 17th, 1999, at 11:58 p.m. in Café Ramírez on the bottom floor of the Mare Magnum Plaza in the port of Barcelona, I fell in love with Spain for the first time. I was 18 years old, traveling around with 28 other students from the Cary High School Spanish program. Our fearless leader, Señora B.A., had studied abroad in Barcelona, and she hoped to show her students a piece of the culture that transformed her life so many years earlier. Her heart was in the right place, but she was simply outmatched by a group of hormonal teenagers 4,000 miles removed from classrooms, homework, parental authority. We arrived at Mare Magnum 30 minutes earlier, a thick pack of teenagers looking to soak up the legendary club scene of Spain. Except that when we got off the elevator, the dance floor was empty. Not a soul besides the bouncer and the bartenders. I grabbed my two closest friends and retreated down into the commercial complex below in search of alcohol. This wasn't just my first time drinking in Spain. It was my first time sitting at a bar, first time speaking Spanish outside of the classroom. I dug deep. Un whisky cola, por favor. The bartender gave a little grin, put two cubes of ice and four fingers of J&B in a tube-shaped glass, and topped it off with Coke. Success! Spanish in action. For the next 2 hours, we put 3 years of Spanish class into extraordinary practice. The bar technically closed at midnight, but the owner and the group of 30-something Catalans were so amused by this rogue crew of Spanglish-speaking Americans that they locked the door with us inside and kept the drinks flowing. With every sip, the Spanish slipped past my lips with greater ease. I started to dig out words I didn't know I knew, combined in ways that kept the conversation marching forward. Not just where are you from, but what do you do? What do you think? What do you believe? When we finally climbed down off our stools, a few sips past the stroke of 2, my entire body was on fire. We made a pact right then, before riding the elevator back up to a by-then-packed disco. We would spend the next 10 days putting it all on the line, drinking absinthe off La Rambla, eating tapas in the back streets of Toledo, dancing until sunrise in Madrid. But we would do it all in Spanish. On Tuesday, March 27th, 2002, at 11:47 a.m. at stall number 570, the Maria Pujol Fruteria, two-thirds of the way back in the Mercat de la Boqueria in the Ciutat Vella of Barcelona, I fell in love with Spain for the second time. I arrived in the city 6 weeks earlier and settled in for my semester abroad in the Catalan capital. My only request was that whomever I lived with allowed me to cook my own meals. College awakened in me an intense desire to experiment in the kitchen, and more than studying, I looked forward to raiding the Spanish markets for new ingredients to discover. Since most host families rely on cooking for their student guests for extra income, the study abroad program paired me with Teresa, a single Catalan woman in her late 40s, who not only didn't cook anything, she didn't eat either. Instead, she drank two bottles of Bach Brut Nature Cava a day on her little patio in the Gracia neighborhood of the city. At first, Teresa proved a fun hostess. In the window between when the first bottle woke her up and the second bottle put her down, she'd engage me in intense conversations about the post-9/11 world America was shaping. Like most Spaniards, she longed for the Clinton years. But as her drinking and depression grew in tandem during my first 6 weeks in Spain, I decided to seek out my own accommodations. Just so happened, David Klinker, a friend from UCLA, had a room opening up in an apartment he was renting with a Catalan, an Italian, and a pair of Germans. At that hour, on a Tuesday, I should have been in my Catalan history class, learning about the heroics of Jaume I and Lluís Companys, but we had a big dinner party planned that evening, and I needed a head start on the shopping. I had only recently discovered the Boqueria, the 13th century market at the heart of the Barcelona food chain, and it quickly became my new classroom. A technicolor collision of produce, protein, and human activity that provided the perfect backdrop to the two things that mattered most to me in 2002, cooking and speaking Spanish.
Back for more, eh?
Wait, is he talking to me? I scanned the crowd, saw myself surrounded by a sea of Catalan grandmas with their little produce carts. Just a few words, but words of immeasurable value. Words that meant some part of me belonged to this distant landscape. After these elaborate dinner parties, we would invariably pile onto the metro and make our way to the Raval, to L'Oveja Negra, a loud, dark, cavernous drinking hole known for its density of international revelers. I spent most of my time at the foosball tables watching El Viejo, the old man rumored to be the greatest futbolín player in all of Spain. He wore a jacket with medals pinned on his right breast like a decorated general, and sat there sober, stone-faced, chewing on the butt of a cigar, waiting for his prey to come to him. El Viejo was doling out one of his physical thrashings to a team of stunned Germans one night, when David spotted a beautiful Catalan girl across the room. We grabbed a pitcher of sangria, made our way over, challenged her and her friend to doubles. After a few rounds, we all went out dancing. 2 years later, David married Marta on Coronado Island in Southern California. I lived in Santa Cruz at the time and drove down the coast to the wedding in a $100 used Peugeot I bought with money from my first writing gig. By that point, Barcelona was almost an abstraction, a surreal 6 months transformed into a warm, sunny island in the recesses of my memory. The place destined to live on as an ellipsis in my life. On Friday, September 23rd, 2010, at 6:07 p.m. on the terrace of La Paciencia at the base of La Rambla del Raval, I fell in love with Spain for the third time. I was late, but I needed to buy a cheap cell phone, just in case. Laura was there at one of the metal tables, sipping a caña of Estrella Damm. I arrived in Barcelona 4 days earlier, roughed up from the life I left behind. I had spent the previous 5 years living between Manhattan and Allentown, Pennsylvania, working as the food editor at Men's Health, writing with my former boss a series of nutrition books called Eat This, Not That. It wasn't supposed to be a series, but after the first book sold 1 million copies in its first year, the project took on a momentum of its own. 18 books in 5 years, combined with a day job and the intensity of life in Manhattan, had pushed me to the breaking point. I grew up treating the word no as an allergy, believing that few good things come from those two letters, and the buffet of life that is New York in your 20s preyed upon my weakness. My body showed signs of cracking, my head not far behind. I needed a change. I broke up with my girlfriend of 4 years, said goodbye to my friends, packed a single bag, and left my apartment in the East Village. My plan was as simple as it was unoriginal: move to Italy, write a novel, fall in love with an Italian, and spend a life eating pappardelle and drinking afternoon amari. Barcelona was a pit stop on my way to paradise, a chance to see some old friends and revisit some of my favorite haunts before pushing on to bigger things in Italy. Before leaving, I emailed David and Marta, happily ensconced in their Southern California existence, and asked if they had any friends in the city who might want to grab a beer or a cup of coffee while I was in town. "My sister-in-law, Laura, lives there," David wrote. "Be careful with this one. She's a bit shy. No guarantee she'll respond." I sent her an email, but David was right. No response. Counting down my days to Italy, I traveled up to Girona for a dinner at El Celler de Can Roca, destined to be crowned the best restaurant in the world in the years to follow. The dinner showcased everything I had been reading about in the years since I left Spain, a mixture of technical innovation, whimsy, and concentrations of outrageous flavor and texture that moved me deeply over 22 courses and 4 hours. A single giant shrimp broken down into 7 different aquatic expressions, an earth-shattering beef tartare covered in crunchy pomme soufflé and tiny pellets of mustard ice cream, a dessert served in a halved soccer ball presented as un gol de Messi. As dinner wound down, I sat with the Roca brothers, Joan the chef, Josep the sommelier, Jordi the pastry chef, and listened to them say very smart things about food and life in Spain. Afterward, I sat alone on the steps of the church perched above old Girona and looked out across Catalunya. Did I just have the best meal of my life by myself? Were those tears of joy or fear or desperation I fought off during dinner? What the fuck am I doing here? Back at the hotel, I opened up my inbox and found an email from Laura in Spanish. "I'm sorry for not responding earlier. I just found your email in my spam folder. I'd love to have a beer before you leave for Italy. How about tomorrow at 6 p.m.? You choose the place." Little did she know that I had already mapped out a plan as soon as I sent that first email, a little bar crawl that would allow me to feign a backstreet Barcelona knowledge in a casual, seemingly spontaneous romp through the Raval. I didn't want to be another American passing through, even if that was exactly what I was. After beers at La Paciencia, we pushed deeper into the neighborhood, to El Celler den Frank Peterson. Owned by Armando, a Guinean immigrant with a high-wattage smile and wry sense of humor, the bar is one of the last of a dying breed of old-school bodegas, places where Spaniards go for a quick drink and a snack while buying wine for the week from giant wooden barrels. Bring in anything, a leather wineskin, old water bottles, a Dutch oven, and Armando will fill it for you for €2 a liter. We ate sheep's milk cheese and drank cheap barrel wine. We talked about her sister, about Laura's job at Catalunya's biggest bank, about my marathon meal at Can Roca. I asked her one of my favorite questions to spring on new friends. What would her last meal on earth be? She didn't hesitate. "A plate of jamón, toasted bread rubbed with tomato and olive oil, and a slice of my dad's tortilla." I felt my heart skip a few beats. We moved on to the bar at Dos Palillos, a polished Japanese Catalan restaurant with a hip clientele and a long menu of Eastern-inflected tapas. We ate Iberico pork dumplings and giant red shrimp, washed down with cava, which I discovered was Laura's lifeblood. I asked her what it was like having her sister so far away. She asked me why I left New York. At 10 p.m., we parted ways. Laura had a late dinner with a group of friends. I had plans to drink with a chef I had met a few days earlier. We shared a taxi uptown, and when I dropped her off at the restaurant, I gave her the number to my new red plastic 10-euro mobile, just in case. I spent the next few hours at an awesome piano bar, the kind you daydream about from across the Atlantic, drinking cocktails and bantering with the chef and his wife. But I wasn't there. I was still back in the streets of the Raval, reliving the last few hours in my head, wondering if she found that taxi ride as excruciating as I did. At 2 a.m., my little red cell buzzed in my pocket for the first time. ¿Qué haces? What are you up to? I put my trip to Italy on hold and spent the next two nights wandering the Ciutat Vella until daybreak. We treated the narrow passages and hard angles of the old city like a Rubik's Cube to solve together. On the third night, I invited Laura over to my rented apartment and made her the dinner I had been cooking in my head since the moment we met at La Paciencia. Gnocchi with duck ragu, topped with a bit of shaved orange and bitter chocolate. We rolled the gnocchi together, drank cava, ate vanilla gelato with coarse sea salt and emerald olive oil. One of those nights that lives on a loop in your head. Ana Laura Perez Gonzalez was born on June 19, 1987, in Igualada, a town of 50,000 in the interior of Catalunya. Her parents came to the region as teens, both part of the Andalusian exodus to the north. Her mother from Jaén, the olive oil capital of the world, her father from the Cave communities outside of Granada. Ángel ran a branch of Catalunya Caixa, one of the region's largest banks, and Laura was, in some way, set to follow in his footsteps. She studied accounting at the University of Barcelona and worked at a local branch of the Caixa. She had traveled outside the country just twice, to France with her family and to California for her sister's wedding, but said she was anxious to see more of the world. There were many things to love about Laura, her generous sense of humor, her mixture of schoolgirl innocence and old soul wisdom, her ability to derive deep reservoirs of pleasure from life's little moments, like cracking the burnt sugar crust of a crema catalana. And, to be completely honest, what struck me most that first night, as we hopped around the Raval, were her long brown hair, chestnut skin, wide, bright eyes that conveyed nothing but warmth and humility. I felt the earth opening up inside me. But it wasn't an entirely monogamous love. Barcelona was a mistress we shared, and everything we did together. We ate jamón and roasted pepper sandwiches at Can Pasciano near the port, elbow to elbow with the mass of old Catalans and young travelers that stormed the old bar for its salted pork and cheap house champagne, drank elaborate gin tonics in big-bellied Cabernet glasses with horn-rimmed hipsters at Pesca Salada in the Raval, took walks down the beach for the smoked paella and bay scallops at Caicu, at the edge of Barceloneta, a few steps from the Mediterranean. With every day came memories of a place I wanted to make my own years earlier, the early morning light against the palm trees and arches of the Plaza Real, the skateboarders, the world's best, attacking the smooth ledges and stone gaps of the Modern Art Museum, the old men in Speedos playing petanca at the beach, their skin like overcooked hot dogs, the way Catalans wish the entire bar a good day as they come and go. Whatever tide of doubt and confusion that came pouring out of me days earlier on the steps of Girona suddenly seemed very far away. Why start from scratch, language, friends, local knowledge, when I had roots in Barcelona? Why chase an Italian when you can give yourself to a Catalan? I traded my temporary apartment in for a long-term rental. and unpacked my bag. Every great ancient city needs a powerful origin story. Barcelona's starts with Hercules. 400 years before the founding of Rome, on the hunt for the Golden Fleece with Jason and the Argonauts, our hero loses one of his 9 ships to the rough seas and begins a desperate search to recover it. He finds it washed up on the shores of Catalunya, and Hercules and his crew are so taken by the area's beauty that they build a city and name it after the 9th ship, Barca Nona. In truth, the Romans built Barcelona, at least the first lasting iteration of it. They called it Barquino, a seat of governance for the Iberian outpost of the empire, not big enough to merit a Colosseum or an amphitheater like Tarragona to the south, but important enough to construct a 2-mile defense wall to protect the 5,000 or so inhabitants living in Barquino by the 2nd century. In the 1,000 years after the fall of the Roman Empire, Barcelona became a revolving door for the forces that stirred across Western Europe. Jewish settlers seeking a place beyond persecution, Visigoths in search of a seat for their volatile empire, Muslim forces looking to extend their growing presence in Iberia. The golden age of Barcelona came in the early part of the 14th century, when deep coffers and naval dominance gave the Catalans control over most of the Mediterranean. First, they took Sicily, later Constantinople, Athens, Corsica, Sardinia, and Naples. While trade, banking, and art flourished, the master builders of the 14th century constructed the stone core of Barcelona that still stands today, and the sense of a national Catalan identity began to take shape. As Cullum Tobin, the Irish author who has lived on and off in the city for years, observes in Homage to Barcelona, "This feeling that as intellectuals, humanists, inventors, writers, and entrepreneurs, they had risen above Spain would never leave Catalan consciousness." By the time Cristobal Colón returned to Catalunya in 1493 to announce to Ferdinand and Isabella his discovery of a new world passage, Barcelona had already lost much of its wealth and prominence around the Mediterranean. The statue commemorating the Italian explorer at the base of La Rambla today is marked by 2 historical curiosities, the first being that he stands pointing southeast across the sea, away from America. The second, that the statue celebrates the very voyage that was a death blow to the Mediterranean trade routes that gave Barcelona its importance. For the next 2 centuries, Catalunya struggled to retain its autonomy amid the rising power in central Spain. On September 11th, 1714, after withstanding 15 months of a punishing siege by the forces of Philip V, the Catalans lost the War of the Spanish Succession and officially became a part of Spain. This wasn't just a political annexation, but a systemic dismantling of Catalan culture. Books were burned, classrooms shuttered, and churches remade as all signs of Catalan language and heritage were banned from the region. September 11th remains Catalunya's national day, when flags and firecrackers and the words of El Segadors, the national anthem, fill the streets. Triumphant Catalunya will once again become rich and full. By the beginning of the 20th century, those words came to life in the streets of the Gothic Quarter as a new wave of Catalan nationalism took hold in the city. After 2 decades of political turbulence among the anarchists, communists, and conservatives vying for power, 2 radical figures, Francesc Macià and Lluís Companys, swept the 1932 elections on a platform of national pride and promptly made Catalan the official language of the new government. A resurgence of Catalan art and literature took hold across the region, but the high times were short-lived. Fascism was afoot across Europe, and General Francisco Franco was on the march from his exile in the Canary Islands. At the dawn of the Spanish Civil War, Barcelona was a hotbed of political angst and escalating violence. Anarchists struck first, burning buildings and executing city officials and members of the city's clergy by the hundreds, followed by the Soviet-backed communists looking to exploit the splintering city. By the time Franco arrived, Catalunya was in disarray most of its leaders having escaped to France as political refugees. That didn't stop Franco and his fascist allies, Germany and Italy, from carpet-bombing Barcelona and systematically erasing all traces of Republican sympathy. Mass executions, political imprisonments, torture. The scars from this dark, cruel period cut so deep that many in Spain still refuse to discuss what happened here in the 1930s. It wasn't just leftist sympathizers Franco snuffed out. He intended to blast Catalan culture out of existence. If your parents named you Jordi at birth, you were now Jorge. If you wanted to speak Catalan, you did it behind closed doors. Camp Nou, FC Barcelona's massive soccer stadium, famously became one of the few places where Catalan pride persisted publicly, establishing the team's political roots and giving FC Barça its now legendary slogan, Més que un club, more than a club. With the death of Franco in 1975 came the uncorking of Catalan culture as the region embraced its language, history, and cuisine with the intensity of a nation rediscovering itself. All of these good vibes and big ambitions won Barcelona the 1992 Summer Olympics, an opportunity that the architects of the Catalan resurgence harnessed to erase decades of dormancy and catapult Barcelona to international stardom. Today, the battle for Catalan independence rages fiercer than ever. The secession movement took on new momentum in the wake of the Spanish crisis, a crippling economic downturn that left national unemployment at record levels. Catalans, tired of answering to a central government they view as corrupt and unjust, have turned out en masse in protest and in referendums to show their support for independence. Depending on whom you talk to in Spain, it's either the latest iteration of Catalunya's superiority complex or the inexorable march toward the independence Catalunya has always deserved. Regardless of how this all plays out, it's clear that the rift between Catalunya and the rest of Spain has gone well beyond name-calling and petty stereotypes and into more nefarious territory. Like a couple's quarrel gone off the rails, both sides are saying and doing things that they simply can't take back. Whether by decree or by default, Catalunya will be an island in the Sea of Spain for many years to come. I may have already written the ending to my Spanish telenovela, but not everyone read the script. A few days after moving into my new place, my little red phone buzzed again. We need to talk. The four most dreaded words budding love has ever known. We met at a shitty cafe down the street from my apartment. I didn't want to ruin a good bar with a painful conversation. And it was. This isn't the right time for me. I like you a lot, but I'm not ready for this. I rolled the words in Spanish around in my head, stared at them from every angle, hoping to wring from them some alternative truth. I tried my own words, something feeble about the risks in life worth taking, but they fell to the ground, lifeless. We parted ways with a vague promise to continue to hang out around town. I sat stunned in my apartment for days, replaying the magical week, trying to understand where I had gone wrong. I probed David for information, hoping Marta might have some insight into the sudden about-face, but they didn't want to get in the middle of it. I tried to push on with life in the city. I wrote in the mornings, took long bike rides up the coast in the afternoons, got beers with friends in the evenings. Above all, I did what I loved to do most in Barcelona. I ate. I ate in a way I never could when I was dumping my last euros into beers and baguettes during my student days. I ate razor clams and Galician beef in polished places praised by the global food connoisseur. I ate conservas, Spain's exemplary canned seafood, washed down with dark vermouth from bodegas in Poble Sec. I ate shawarma in the Raval, where spinning towers of meat fill the neighborhood at all hours with the smell of garlic and mystery spices. I ate suckling pig roasted in the oven of my rented apartment with everyone I knew in the city gathered around one small table. I ate my way around neighborhoods I had never known before. Poble Nou, an industrial barrio in transition. Sarriá, with its wine bars packed with upper-crust Catalans. And Barcelona was brilliant throughout. But I wanted to share all of these moments with Laura, and I struggled to get past the sting of disappointment that I couldn't. I didn't like the dark alleys my mind was leading me down, so when two friends proposed a trip to northern Italy for truffle season, I packed my bag and said goodbye to Barcelona. In Piedmont, we ate nothing but fragrant tubers for 3 days, aided in our excess by a retired policeman who took us truffle hunting in the hills above Barolo and sent us off with our pockets stuffed with diamonds. A few days later, a train pulled into Bologna Centrale and spit me out into the city that I had originally planned to live in. I found a room in an apartment with a graduate student and a guitar player and enrolled in an Italian school a few blocks from Piazza Maggiore. In Bologna, I found a blueprint for the life I had fantasized about during all those sleepless nights working on the books. I spent my mornings soaking up Italian lessons with a small class of international students. I spent the afternoons trying it out in the little vegetable stands and meat and cheese shops and fresh pasta emporiums that line Via Pescherie Vecchie. A lifelong love of ragu blossomed into a full-blown obsession that sent me by bike and train to all corners of Emilia-Romagna, chasing down the esoteric little differences found between one village's recipe and the next. I found the café of my and every American writer's dreams, filled with animated Italians and oil-thick espresso and a liquor shelf heavy with bitter spirits. I spent many 3 and 4 spritz afternoons there, trying to write my way out of whatever mess I made in Spain. But there wasn't enough Aperol and Agnolotti in all of Italy to lessen the gravitational pull from across the Mediterranean. Things that had absolutely nothing to do with Laura, a statue of Poseidon, a bad pop song, a bubbling tower of lasagne verdi, stirred in me deep pangs of longing. I tried everything to fight off the magnetic pull. I called friends in New York and told them to talk sense into me. I went out drinking with lovely young women from my class, read about ragouts of mythic origins waiting to be devoured. But none of it worked. When I read online that LCD Sound System, one of Laura's favorite groups, was to play at the Razzmatazz Club in Barcelona on the night of November 7th, I bought 2 tickets, canceled the rest of my Italian course, and said goodbye to Bologna. On my train ride to Rome, I wrote an email to a close friend in the States. As much as I may love its beaches and bars and avant-garde structures, as happy as I am playing ping-pong with Salva and watching Barca games with the Jefe, and wandering the jumbled streets of the Raval with a thick international posse, I am really going back for one reason. Her. Barcelona has long had a magnetic pull on its visitors. Hemingway found its bars to be some of the finest watering holes in Europe. Orwell felt so strongly about the city and the region that he took up arms and spent months in the cold, muddy battlefields in northern Catalonia, fighting the fascists. Federico Garcia Lorca, the great Andalusian poet, came to Barcelona in 1925 as a guest of Salvador Dalí and promptly fell in love with Catalunya, its bars and cafes, its community of artists and intellectuals, its free spirit. At the end of a performance of his controversial play Yerma in 1935, in the months before war broke out, he took to the stage and offered, "My heart is with you! Long live Catalunya!" A year later, Franco would have Lorca executed in Granada. Their ghosts can be found everywhere, in the seedy Gothic plaza named for Orwell, or at the Hotel Majestic on Paseig de Gracia, where Lorca spent 4 of his last months on Earth, or on the dust that covers the absinthe bottles at Bar Marsella, seemingly untouched since the days when Papa tussled with the green fairy here. It's hard to think of a city that wears its charms more conspicuously than Barcelona. They're all there for you to absorb, one by one, mountain and sea, wide, majestic avenues and tiny, lonely backstreets, oil-slicked shoebox bars and opulent eateries of innovation. Spend a perfect day in Barcelona, one that starts early wandering the streets of the Gothic Quarter, magical at dawn before the city fully stirs. Move on to breakfast at the Boqueria, perhaps a plate of garbanzos spiked with blood sausage and raisins from Pinochu, washed down with a few glasses of jet-cold cava, followed by some time lost in the grip of Gaudí, the psychonaturalism of Parc Güell, maybe, or the dueling apartment buildings of Paseig de Gracia, before retiring to the beach for a crock of soupy lobster rice and a siesta on the sands of the Barceloneta, a recharge for the nighttime tapas crawl through Gracia or Born that will carry you from bar to bar into the early morning. Spend a perfect day in Barcelona like this, and you'll find yourself saying, "What if?" One time, over a late breakfast at El Quim de la Boqueria, a high-traffic bar in the center of the market serving an expansive menu of seasonal Catalan cooking, I met a short, bald man from Hong Kong and his chopstick-thin girlfriend. The two of them sat at the bar for the better part of 2 hours, silently dismantling every last inch of the menu, grilled asparagus and fried artichokes, braised oxtail, giant plates of seared crustaceans, eggs fried in olive oil and blanketed with baby squid. Finally, after sucking the last shrimp head and swilling the last drops of cava, the man patted his lips with a napkin and turned to me. "I am a businessman from Hong Kong, and I have traveled all around eating at the best restaurants in the world, but I've never eaten as well as I do at this bar. I want to marry her, but first I needed to bring her here to see that she loved it as much as I do. Tonight, I will propose to her." Barcelona will do that to a man. Inspire travel from the corners of the globe for a small taste. Make perfectly brilliant destinations elsewhere feel dim by comparison. But all of this love for the Catalan capital comes at a cost. Barcelona is now the third most visited city in all of Europe, after only Paris and London. Its port houses two of the world's largest cruise ships, the 6,328-passenger Allure of the Seas, and its sister, Harmony of the Seas, twin menaces of the Mediterranean that, along with a fleet of countless others, have ushered in a homogeneous cruise ship economy. You need only follow the souvenir shops and the paella signs to understand the trampled trail of the 8-hour tourist, up La Rambla, around Plaza de Catalunya, climbing Paseig de Gracia past Gaudí's two famous apartment buildings, and ending beneath the towering spires of the Sagrada Familia. The architects of post-Olympic Barcelona never imagined the city in the grip of such a mongrel mass of British stag parties, Russian yacht barons, and Chinese tour buses. To make matters worse, 2014 marked the end of a grandfathered lease agreement that capped rent for old, family-run businesses deemed a vital part of the city's social fabric. The rent on toy stores and candy makers and small workshops occupying the most coveted real estate in the high-traffic corners of the old city rose by thousands of euros overnight. The rise of shoe stores, souvenir shops, and bike rentals continues to consume the city's historic heart. Citizens have revolted. Catalans, adhering to a long tradition of airing their grievances as publicly as possible, organize in front of City Hall in Plaza Sant Jaume to remind the politicians of the body they were elected to govern. Red spray paint on ancient walls issue stiff warnings to foreigners. Guidis, go home. Banners and flags across the Ciutat Vella that hang from balconies across the old city paint a troubling picture. Shh! Let us sleep. We want a dignified barrio. In 2015, Ada Colau and her band of progressive socialists swept into office on a campaign to fight the forces of Barcelona tourism. Proposals on the table include a moratorium on all new hotels, adding tourist taxes, capping cruise ship parking, and actively combating luxury tourism. "I don't want a city that only snobs come to," she told the press. Some say this is biting the hand that feeds the city, spiting an evergreen industry that has buoyed Barcelona as the rest of the country suffers through a financial crisis. But most citizens applaud her crusade, desperate for some signal from the government that this city is still theirs. I arrived to Barcelona El Prat Airport at 3 p.m. on November 7th, with two tickets to LCD sound system, a liter of Campari, a quarter wheel of Parmigiano Reggiano, a bottle of 50-year-old balsamic vinegar, a quarter kilo each of thinly sliced mortadella, culatello, and finocchiona, plus two freshly dug white truffles, roughly the size of a small boy's fist. An excessive haul, I admit, but once you go on a pantry run, the procuring takes on a momentum of its own. The only thing I didn't have was a firm plan. I had rented an apartment on Carrer dels Escuderes in the Gothic Quarter for 3 nights. 2 days earlier, I sent a text to Laura. Will you be in Barcelona on Saturday night? I have a friend who has a package for you. I am a man of the grand gesture, the meticulous construction of the big moment, and the text bought me just enough time to figure it out. I dropped the supplies off at the apartment and walked furiously around the neighborhood, looking for inspiration. I passed by Mao's, a falafel shop on Carrer de Ferran I used to frequent in 2002, and as I stuffed my pita with pickled peppers, a light bulb began to flicker. I tore out a page from my notebook, scribbled a few words in Spanish, folded the note, and passed it to the dreadlocked blonde working the fryer. A young brunette Catalan about this tall is going to come here at 7 p.m. When you see her, please pass her this note. I ran down the street to a small corner market, wrote down another few words on a notebook page that I folded and handed to the Middle Eastern man behind the register. A young brunette Catalan about this tall is going to come in here around 7:15 p.m. and is going to buy 2 oranges and a head of garlic. When she does, please hand her this note. At 6 p.m., I sent Laura a message. Me. Be in front of Mao's falafel shop on Ferran at 7 p.m. Her. I don't understand. Are you here? Me. Don't worry. All will become apparent soon enough. Just be there at 7. Her. All right. The text led her to the first note. The first note led her to the second, and the second led her to me, sitting on the steps of Plaza Tripi with the third and final note. She didn't say anything, just opened it. Te echo de menos. I miss you. What followed felt like a courtship sequence from a Wes Anderson film. Rounds of tapas and cava at two of my favorite little bars, followed by a 2-hour, head-rattling, soul-shaking performance from LCD sound system in front of 1,500 rabid Spaniards. We stood in the front row and danced like a pack of teenagers on MDMA. Afterward, we went to Dos Cielos, a Michelin-starred restaurant on the 26th floor of the Hotel May, where we drank gin tonics and ate snacks with the chef while all of Barcelona shimmered below us. At 5 a.m., we ended up in the kitchen at my rented apartment, and I put the Italian treasure to work, a plate of Parmesan chunks and thin slices of cured pork, a Campari spritz made with the oranges Laura had purchased earlier in the market, and to close, a plate of eggs fried in olive oil. Laura held her plate as I showered it with thin slices of white truffle, an overwhelming fragrance of funk and pheromones filling the room. If I got down on a knee right then to propose, I was certain she would be mine. But I was alone in that thought. Laura ate her eggs, drank the last of her spritz, and stood up to leave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.